everyone, my name is Samuel Ademi. Welcome once again to this YouTube channel, Small Gap TV. I want you to please subscribe to this YouTube channel so that you get notifications whenever we're dropping any godly, meaningful content, inspiring content. Thank you. I'm Samuel Hadim and I'll be speaking today on Introduction to Power of Imagination and Creative Speaking. Week 2, Introduction to Power of Imagination and Creative Speaking, POI 101. Without mincing words here, the crux is sharpen your imagination by getting exposed beyond your scope of reality. Sharpen your imagination by getting exposed beyond your scope of reality. We're speaking about Introduction to Power of Imagination and Creative Speaking. So that means you must, for you to have to be a creative speaker, you must be able to sharpen your imagination by getting exposed beyond your scope of reality, beyond your scope of information. You must be able to widen your horizon even as a speaker as well. That means you must have a zeal of empathy to dig deep into the lives of people while you speak. You must have a zeal of empathy, you must have a zeal of imagining as if you are those people who are the empathy. You must have a zeal of empathy to dig into the lives of people while you speak. By this, you will command respect. In other words, while you are speaking as if you are in the position of what that sister or what that brother is passing through. Or you are speaking in the position of what that apprentice is passing through. You are speaking in the position of what that technician or what that medical practitioner or what that academician or what that trader is passing through. That is what empathy is all about. By this, you will be able to command respect. And in the religious world, religious setting, for example, many have observed personally that many ministers of God, many pastors speak and preach, of course, on salvation. And I believe in that as well. Apologies to those who are not Christians, and of course, you need to be saved also. Pastors speak on salvation and they speak on repentance. But the question I've always observed is how many care to speak and preach on loneliness that pushes people into immorality? How many people preach and speak and care about the lives of people, even just beyond the church? It's not just about saying you must be saved, you must be saved only. They're able to empathize with what people are passing through. Imagine a sister who is having about five younger ones, the parents are dead, they are all orphans, and then she has to care for the family. And the next thing you just keep emphasizing on is about you must be saved, you must repent. You must be able to show a sense of empathy. Dig deep and imagine what they are passing through before you just start condemning them and say, why are they involving in immorality? This is not a yardstick to involve in immorality, but of course, I'm trying to tell you about the way where you can speak creatively to be able to bring out the best in yourself first, and then you'll be able to pass across your good messages and transforming speech that, life-changing, revolutionary talk that will bring out people from their present way of information or present way of life. Or imagine when you are telling people that, okay, don't just smoke. And they find themselves in a situation that the only friend that they have at that particular time is a smoker, and who is telling him that if you are staying with me, then you must involve in whatever it is I'm doing. So if you as a speaker or as a preacher or as, of course, maybe an orator and all that, you have a sense of empathy. You should be able to ask, but you're able to imagine that what if I'm in the shoe of this person, that the only people that he's surrounding himself with. Of course, power of imagination or association is very, very important and key in life. And that's how you'll be able to make sure that you understand who he or she is associating himself or herself with. This is going to help you to be able to empathize and be able to know how to speak creatively. That despite you want to tell them that don't go into this addiction or stop this addiction or stop this immorality or stop whatever it is wrong that you are doing, you must first be able to empathize with them. You see from their eye view first, then you now tell them that I understand how you feel. By the time you start saying this word, like, oh, I can imagine how you feel, but I want you to check it from this aspect that God loves you, Jesus loves you, to be able to make them receptive, and before you know, you're already bringing out your public speaking skill, and from there you are transforming the lives of people. And that is why there's need for creative thinking here. You see, another thing that I have here for you is the issues of teenagers. you know, for example, and you know, the sexual abuse can never be overemphasized. So there are a lot of these are topics that are so rare as compared, even in religious settings. You know, a lot of people will just speak on, you know, maybe leadership only as good as it is. They might speak about deliverance as good as it is. They might speak about a lot of diverse stuff. They might speak of salvation, as we said earlier as well. They might speak about holiness. They might speak about miracles and, you know, they might speak about gifts and all that. But there are some topics that can never be overemphasized. When the world that is getting more corrupt daily, and that means we need more talks, we need more speech, we need more information that will bring out more from sexual abuse. And these are what many of the teenagers are passing through. And many of them cannot speak out. They can't speak out. Just like I always say, permit me as a filmmaker, I've always said it several times that people always believe that the only film you can do is a film of the houses have explicit scenes, or you know, just kissing or immoral scenes and all that. No, you can write a film on politics, you can write a film that leads to health, you can write a film that talks about social issues in the world, social vices and all that. You can write films on even sexual abuse as well. There are a lot of stories and a lot of topics as well that could be shared and will transform the life of people. So, and you know, everyone needs a shoulder to lean on. So you must be able to think creatively so that you're able to speak, and then the audience will always anticipate listening to you. When they discover that you have the ability to think creatively, you have the ability to speak creatively, and then you have the ability to empathize with them in whatever I think they are passing through, then you always discover that there's more to say, and then you always have more audience than willing to listen to you. So beyond you having a catchy title, beyond you having the structure of your communication, you must be able to have this creative mindset of what empathizing with your audience. And when you empathize, you'll be able to think that, okay, how does a politician think? You see, how does a leader think in a particular position? How does it seem to be lonely in a particular situation as well? How does it mean to be a lonely follower? How does it mean to be a leader who is taking a strong decision alone? And you know, you have leaders as well who are listening to you in whatever it is you are saying. So they want to know that this person has or understand what I'm passing through as well, the pain and affliction of faithful leaders. When I minister that that message to a particular set of people, you know, it made those who are actually leaders to know that they are not the only one in that situation. There's a way of escape as well. There's a way that will they come out. So they know that there's somebody who has been in their shoe before or who understands what it is to be a faithful leader and is having pain and all that. It's an empathic speaking that brings out creativeness from the speaker as well. The next topic here is disturbance. You see, a distraction is a disturbance. Of course, now a distraction as a disturbance is bound to occur while speaking. A distraction as disturbance is bound to occur while speaking. So therefore, you must be vast to tactfully include disturbance that appears as distraction into speaking. You see, while you are speaking, one way or the other, maybe you are speaking to a set of people in a well-coordinated and corporate place, one thing or the other can happen. Unforeseen contingencies can arise that happens and results as a form of disturbance. And that distraction will be the disturbance. So you must tactfully include disturbance and be ready to apply. That's creative thinking that appears as distraction into speaking. What do I mean? A practical example is this. I'll explain it now. Imagine a preacher is speaking on repentance and judgment. Imagine a preacher is speaking on repentance and judgment. Then the light was interrupted and everywhere becomes dark for a split of seconds. Imagine, I repeat that, a preacher is speaking on repentance, people should repent, and then talking of judgment on the end time, and then the light goes off. The light was interrupted and everywhere becomes dark for a split of seconds. A creative, imaginative speaker can say, brethren, as the light is off and everywhere is dark, there's a temporary but a time will come. This is temporary, I repeat that. The speaker can say, brethren, as the light is off and everywhere is dark, this is temporary. But the time will come, it will be temporary when you die without accepting Jesus. You will be alone. You are going to face judgment. Are you going to repent now, or you want to face judgment at the last day? So this is a way by which, if the light goes off, you say, brethren, as everywhere is dark now, within the split of seconds, there's going to be a time that you will be alone. And that time that you'll be alone, if you have not repented, you'll be facing eternal judgment. You know, when the audience see this, it will make you be a creative speaker. That's why the light goes off, you quickly know how to switch over using disturbance as a creative way of speaking. That is the power of imaginative speaking as a public speaker. Another one is, okay, still on that, he said, Brethren, as the light is off and everywhere is dark, this is temporal, but the time will come, it will be temporal when you die without accepting Jesus. You alone will be left on your face, as I am left alone on this podium. So the speaker can also still add that despite the light is gone off, that everyone will be alone. He is also left alone on this podium, and that's why on the last day as well, he will also be left on the podium. You know, this can only be achieved by the power of imagination, and this can be done alone by an empty speaker. And that's why we are in this lecture, that's why in the school here to listen and build up your creative and public speaking skill. Or as well, this is another example. You can imagine while speaking, a goat runs into the auditorium. For example, while I'm speaking, a goat runs into the auditorium, or it runs to the hall, and you are speaking about purpose. Now, follow me. You are speaking about purpose, and a goat bodies into the auditorium. You can creatively add, even while people will smile on sighting the goat, of course. You may say this: this goat signifies a directionless young youth, merry-go-rounding in one position, moving from north to south because it lacks bearing. Maybe you are speaking of purpose and why you must be steadfast in your vision, you must not lack purpose and order. And during discussion, maybe a dog just jumps into the enters the hall, or a goat enters the hall. I'm going to use that creative way to speak that listeners, audience, congregation, my friends, as this goat has entered into the auditorium, it seems to be directionless, moving from north to south anyway. Are you also going to behave as this goat that is directionless, being branded as a youth that has no direction? So you see that, immediately you say that, people begin to wonder, now it's time for me to be serious with my life. I don't want to be like this goat who is directionless. So would you choose to be like this goat or take charge of your life? What a good way to end your speech, if it's towards the ending of your speech and that goat just enters. This is power of imagination. A speaker must be ready, and this is one way you can burst into the world of imaginative thinking through people's experience, through books, through tapes. It's another way of imagination and creative speaking. A speaker must be ready, and this is one way you can burst into the world of imaginative thinking through people's experience, books, and tapes. And how can you be ready? It is through that books, it is through that experience of people, it is through tapes. You listen to tapes, it helps you to grow more, to help you to expand your mind. You know, if you are only restricted to knowing something of about that, has a value of 5, if you keep knowing more and you keep learning more, you relearn, you unlearn, and then you learn again. It will make you to be a good creative speaker. In other words, as well, you must state your facts. While you are speaking creatively, you must state your facts. You must explain to them. You argue from your audience. In other words, you must be able to know the words, meaning you accept some information, but why not look at it this way? So that means while you speak to your audience, you make them to make them receptive and listen to you. You accept some of their information, their prior knowledge. You tell them that, okay, it is good to marry early, but you know, yes, when you put that but now, it shows that yes, you are giving them a good reason why they must marry early, but you must be careful, but you must prepare early also. But in the religious setting, you must be prayerful, you must pray well before you get married. When you start putting things like this, you state your facts and you tell them the reason, they'll be willing to hear you. Of course, you must also appeal for action. You must also appeal for action. In other words, that means you must be solution-minded. The action is what the solution that you're about to give to them. Or you show something that is wrong. When you want to speak as well as the power of imaginative speaking, you know, you show something that is wrong, you show how to remedy it, that means you show the solution to it, then you ask for their cooperation. That can we now do this together? That's a way of speaking as well to convince people. And this is what many politicians do. This is the power of imagination. They tell you what is wrong in society, they tell you how to remedy it, and then they ask for your cooperation. And that's why many people fall into the words and all that. In creative speaking, it is not just about what you say, but who says it and how it is said. So it's not just about what you say, but it's about who is saying it also. That means the word, the authority behind that word, and then how is it said. This is why, again, it takes practice to be natural before an audience. It takes practice to be natural before an audience. Actors, of course, they know that, and you have to work out your own public speaking salvation by practice. You have to work out your own public speaking salvation by practice. In other words, you must learn as well to pause after important ideas. You must learn to pause after important ideas. It will make everyone attentive again for those who have lost interest. So you must learn to pause after, you know, important ideas, important views. It makes everyone attentive again for those who have lost that interest. Never you begin with an apology of not preparing. It makes your audience say, there's no use going further. Never you begin with an apology of not preparing. It makes your audience say, there's no need or there's no use going further. You know, I've seen a lot of speakers who are saying that that's a statement of that appears as a means of you being inferior to the other speaker. So whenever you are using this word, of course, listeners are not here to impress you or speak like speaker A or speaker B. It makes you seem as if you are competing or you are trying to bring yourself out to separate yourself and others. No, just go straight to the point and set the ball rolling as a good speaker. Remember, if your first few seconds aren't catchy, it will be difficult to attract and win them back. If your first few seconds are not catchy, it will be difficult to attract and win back your audience. In other words, you must arouse curiosity. You must learn to arouse curiosity. You must begin with a story that is catchy. You must make it emotional. You must be sensitive. You must ask questions. You must open it with a quotation. So I repeat that, you must begin with a story that is catchy, you must make it emotional, you must be sensitive about it, you must ask questions as well, why you are about to speak or you have started as well. You must open with a quotation, it's good as well, these are various ways but not limited to this. You can begin on some notes and go straight into the personal interest of the hearers. You can start with something that will catch the hearers and go into their interest. You know, dig deep into what you are around them. So remember to avoid as well technical terms. Remember to avoid technical terms or you fine-tune it to the audience's taste. In other words, if you are speaking to everyone, you don't necessarily need to keep using big vocabulary that many will not understand. While it is good for people to also up their game and, you know, get to the level that you have, it will be so wrong if you are speaking some medical terms known as medical jargons to set of secondary school holders and they are trying to tell them something that appears vague to them because they really don't understand it. And the essence of you speaking is to carry quality as well. So remember to avoid technical terms or you fine tune it to the audience's taste. As a rule, which is my rule, a good public speaker or speaking is not in the efficacy of the grammar mortar, but in the ability to make your audience receptive to your standpoint and bring myriad of change to their lives. I repeat that. As a rule, which is my rule, a good public speaker speaking is not in the efficacy of grammar, mortar, but in the ability to make your audience receptive to your standpoint and bring myriad of change to their life. So it's not just about how good, how eloquent you are in just speaking alone, why does this have its own place, but it's what ability to make the audience listen to you and the ability to bring a change to their life. So it is good to not let your audience remain the same whenever I think you are speaking. So, and even as well, you know, I've gone to programs, I've gone to seminars, I've listened to in religious setting as well. There are sometimes that when I listen to some things, it's just as same as if I didn't come because I was not impressed, nothing really changed, and all that. These people lack the power of creative speaking or art of public speaking. So, for you not to be seen as such a kind of person, because if I get to a place, my intention personally, and that's the intention of all listeners, I believe, is to be able to gain something new in the religious setting for their lives to be transformed, in the secular setting to be able to up their game in whatever it is they are doing. So if you now get to that kind of place and then nothing really changed, it's just like a time wasted. And that's why I select places that I go to. I select things that I do so that I won't just waste time. Because time, of course, they say, is money. But time, of course, as well, it is life. Time is life. Okay, books, yes, books. He who would think creatively must learn to enrich and soak himself with stocks of books. You know, stock of books constantly. So that it will increase your mental strength. So that you will not be stagnant. So if you want to be creative, you must keep reading books. You must be a reader. You must increase your horizon through books. And I've emphasized on that earlier as well. So you must learn also to arouse eagerness for listening from your audience. Learn to arouse eagerness for listening from your audience. One way to achieve this is to use captivating words. You know, when you use captivating words, it arouses eager from your audience. And then, of course, the topic also. Use captivating words, use captivating topic, but make sure the topic collides with the expectation of your audience. So if your topic is catchy, then it collides as well with the expectation of your audience. So you arouse eagerness for listening from your audience. The thing is, to connect with your audience, for you to connect with your audience, you need to understand why your topic is important to them. So you must be able to know the reason why your topic is important to your audience. What do they expect to learn from the presentation? What does your audience expect to learn from your presentation? Don't assume the audience is like you. Not everyone will definitely be like you. So they may have cultural or geographic biases. And the more you understand them, the better you can express yourself to them and avoid speaking gaffes. So you know, that means what? You must know that your audience are coming from different radio settings. They have different cultural background. They have different geographic settings and location and biases. So the more you understand this, the better it is going to be able to express yourself. So you must have this mindset of diversification. Maybe you are from culture A and you are speaking in culture B. You must be able to understand the way by which culture B operates, so that whenever you are speaking, you'll be able to carry them along and they will feel relaxed, they will feel receptive, they will feel comfortable having you speaking to them. It is important as well to know the level of knowledge they have about your topic, so you can present the information with the correct tone to keep people interested and, you know, engaged. So when you know that they have a certain level of information, then you build on top to help them to be engaged. There's nothing more insulting than to present basic information to a highly knowledgeable audience. I repeat that. There's nothing more insulting to present basic information to a highly knowledgeable audience. Imagine somebody who is in primary 6 and you are telling him okay, let's use this example, this practical example. Imagine somebody who is in SS3 and you are, and the teacher comes to the class, a mathematics teacher comes to the class and is trying to teach them the mathematical times table. That is an error. So in other words, it means it is more insulting to present basic information to a highly knowledgeable audience. It's not good as well when you are speaking to a high, when you speak too high a level to a novice audience. In other words, when you speak at a high pitch and not in terms of your voice now, you are speaking something that is so high that is beyond the comprehension of the novice audience. Why it is good for them to also upgrade themselves? You must be able to carry them along. So it will be wrong if you are speaking to those who have a limited knowledge, you are speaking far beyond them. For example, before you minister deliverance naturally to people, or before you minister something about healing and all that, it is very good as a basis to minister salvation to them, so that they will first know God as the healer and as the savior rather. They first know God as the savior before knowing him as the healer. It will be an error when they know God as the healer first before knowing him as the savior. So that we give a wrong foundation. The next time they are coming again, they will be looking for God the healer instead of God the savior. So if you are speaking something that is not highly knowledgeable to a set of poor novices, it will not help them. It will not help them. So in other words, to get that information, present basic information to those who are in the basic level. Slowly, they begin to rise and take it higher. And then you present something more knowledgeable as well to those who are highly knowledgeable. So the way you speak to those who are professors or emeritus professor is different from the way you speak to somebody who is a degree holder. And the way you speak to a degree holder should be different from the way you speak to somebody who is in primary or the secondary school. So you must be able to know the differences and know how to carry everyone along. Time comes with the audience seems code. Okay? Time comes when the audience will seem code. As a speaker, you must learn to be at alert to ask a similar question like, I think I just lost you. By the time you say that, the audience will revive themselves. So I see the many speakers when they speak and all that, you get to a certain level, people are already sleeping, people are already tired. They don't know how to carry the speaker, the audience alone. That is wrong because they don't have the good mindset in public speaking. So time comes when the audience seems cold, you must learn as a speaker to make them alert by asking questions like, for example, not limited to this alone. I think I just lost you. By the time you say that, it will bring around back their interest in listening to you. And you can say something like, can you just tell me why I just lost you? You see, however, this is why you must say something that you must have earned the right to talk about, so that you will not even still lose the audience, which you might lose at times. The main reason why you lose them is because maybe you are speaking about something you don't have the right, or you've not earned the right to talk about. Because when you have the right to talk about something and it's very interesting and catchy, and you have the good mindset to speak in terms of creative imagination, the art of public speaking, the structure of communication, your topic is catchy, your content is so good and all that, it will be difficult to lose them. Meanwhile, don't forget, 15%, you lose 15% of your audience every second. Your good speaker can work on that, and then you will begin to bring out the best in himself. So you must talk from inside out. You must talk from inside out. Too many bad speakers and even creators speak so much on topics they have little or no experience about. I keep emphasizing on this because it's very, very important. Very, very important. What topic, the topic that you don't have knowledge about, better you don't speak about it. The topic you don't have experience about, it's better you don't speak about it. Let you bar your public speaking, your public speaking, whenever you're speaking. So it's very good to speak about what you know about. You do what you can do, and you don't do what you can do. That is just the rule. So you really can't know all. You must know that you really can't know all. So major on your major, and be a voice to be reckoned with in that area. Major on your major, major on your major. There are many people that you know that they are good in this particular area. Why it is good to be jack? You know, there's popular saying, jack of all trade, master of none. I believe in jack of all trade, and you can grow to be master of all. But while you are growing in that area, don't come out as if you are now, you now know everything in that area. Or that area that you are most good at, you must be good at something. That should be the area you must always talk about most time. But you must be growing other areas too, because there will be a time that will come that the area they are good at is not the only area that the audience needs. They need another area they are not good at. And if you don't have that area as well, they can definitely go to another place. I think this is mostly common, even in religious setting as well. That when a minister does not have a grace at a particular level, you see the members of the audience going to another place again. You don't get annoyed with them because they are going to somewhere else. If you don't have that level of grace, or you don't have that level of what they need, they want to learn from somewhere. So it's for you to up your game, up your spiritual life as well in terms of religious setting. And in other areas as well, of course, as a filmmaker as well, I have my strengths, I act, I direct, I shoot, I edit, and I do a lot of things in terms of the filmmaking, but I have my area of strengths very well. So I develop more in that area while I also grow in those areas that I also have information about, but I'm not an authority in that area. So major on your major and be a voice to your companies in that area. Your progress as a speaker will depend far more on your choosing the right topic to talk about than upon your native ability as a speaker. Your progress as a speaker will depend far more on your choosing the right topic to talk about than upon your native ability as a speaker. If possible, speak in relation to immediate seasons. Speak in relation to immediate seasons. In other words, for example, maybe towards the end of the year, and then you're about to speak to a group of professionals and all that. You know, everybody in their company, they begin to do all their gross profits and their net income and all that. So you speak in relation to that. Maybe, for example, in a religious setting, and towards the end of the year, you can bring up a topic that says, examine yourself. Or even in the beginning of the year, you can also bring something like that, examine yourself. So you must be able to bring seasonal topics that meet the immediate season of that particular situation after all that particular era to make you a creative speaker. This is a quick one. Audience are time pressed. The audience are content driven. The audience are results oriented. Audience work with time, they love time, they are content driven, they want content, they want to hear you say something that they are able to put down and write down, especially for religious and etc. And they are result oriented. So for you, so you speak rightly and not just jokes. You know, most time, like I've said to some group of people generally as well, to those who know me so well, we have emotional audience. Emotional audience, especially in the religious setting, you know, most time there's this kind of bias that the religious mindset have. But I always tell you that I think objectively. By God's grace, I'm also a minister of God. But in reality, in the quest to satisfy your leader, in the quest to satisfy what appears to be spiritual authority or spiritual leader, I see a lot of people who try to just put down what even seems unnecessary just to satisfy their leader. You see, and this will not make you to be a good speaker. If people are just doing it to satisfy you, within them, they know that they are just writing for writing's sake. So, and it has nothing to their knowledge. So there's no point really writing it. So those who are writing, they are writing the result of the just want to make you, they are just trying to empathize with you, or whatever is the word, let's think, put a better word there, they are trying to sympathize with you. Instead of them to really know that they are getting something, they know within them they are not getting anything, but they just write it down for the sake of law, that you must write something down, or for the sake of, in the name of God. So, people need content. So, whenever you are saying something, make sure that your words have content. Make sure that your words are result-oriented. Make sure that you are a time-conscious person. Time, they say, is money. Time, they say, is life. So, if you get to a time when you keep speaking, the audience will be tired and they leave. In a setting that, because they are bound by a particular law, mostly in a religious setting, they want to stay. But in reality, their mind are no longer there, even despite they are sitting there. In closing your talk, never end with, this is all I have to say on the matter. This is all I have to say. It's a wrong statement to use. Or you say, this is all I have to say, I guess I'll stop here. That's for amateurs. You know, let your closing be smooth and don't cease suddenly. So when you are ending, close smoothly and don't just cease suddenly and then. Don't just be abrupt in your speech, in the ending of your speech. Don't make it just be abrupt. No. Always try to summarize your points depending on the topic of discourse or close with a poetical quotation.